Welcome back to the main stage. We started this morning with a great show, and now we are back with a great debate. Did you enjoy your day? Yeah, I hope so. We do something, we do a little different time frame. My name is Nart Strøs, and I work in EHiN in Norway. And I think it would be interesting to get some people who know the future, who come from the future, and bring them back to 2016 and let them tell how the future is going to look like. Because we have some very nice speakers, and I think they know, they have a kind of view into what technology can do with healthcare into the future. And we're going to talk with them. It's going to be very easy. We sit at the sofa, we discuss, we might agree, we might disagree, and we look into things of what is going to happen with personalized medicine. How do we get there? Is there any way we can change, manage the changes? How are we going to work with all the healthcare that's coming to us in the years to come? And the format is that they're all four. We actually had one fifth person, but he's not here yet. We hope he come. All have a little pitch about an item which they think it's very important for the healthcare in the future. And there is the number five. Okay. Yeah, go and get your microphone. Do you have a microphone?
No.
You can get it over there. So that's good. Are we a complete team? They all got their little pitch about an item from the healthcare which they think is very important. And then we'll talk about this like 8 or 10 minutes and we take the next pitch. So that's the format. I hope you enjoy it. All these people have a CV which is so long as if I start reading them, we don't have time to debate. So I'll take a very short introduction. You find everything on them in the app or in the website. And Hel Wolf, hi Hel. We're working at Kaiser Permanente. Now you're working at Chartis. You're a healthcare experiment from the United States. Know really a lot.
Thank you for having me.
Elena Bonfiglione, the head of Microsoft Europe Healthcare. Amy Quaver, some people have been seeing you today before from MedPal. And Andrew Watson, who is a surgeon at UPMC in the United States, working a lot with the practical healthcare and doing also the technology and the telemedicine, which is very interesting. And then, last but not least, Erik Foster from the Interventor Center in the University Hospital of Oslo. Welcome, all of you. So, there is a big question, because everybody's saying healthcare is under a lot of pressure. And we're getting older, we got more lifestyle illness, and we don't have enough money and resources to do this. The other side is that we have a technology revolution who is going very quick and which is going to help us to solve these problems. So then the question is, which of the two is going fastest? The problems we get, or is it the technology revolution which is going to solve these problems? Anyone wants to jump in? The first one?
I can go.
Elena.
I would say thanks for having us back from the future. Mm-hmm. As nor one nor the other is our willingness to embrace technology and change that will define our ability to succeed. So I'll put it right there.
Hel?
Well, I think the question that you're raising, which is a change management question, is spot on. Mm. We're in the throes of it, but this is one of the largest change management efforts ever. Mm-hmm. And if we're really looking back and coming from the future back in, we're probably not going to handle it very well. Change is really, really hard. And there's a tremendous amount of vested interest in keeping the system the way it is. And I think the economic forces are finally colliding. The capabilities are there, technology, but it's the people and it's the processes that sit behind it that really are the key to success.
Okay. So, Erik, what do you think about Norway? Are we keeping up with the technology revolution, or are we falling behind?
The problem, I think, has been very well emphasized here, because the technology is evolving and we like to use it, but it requires changes in organization, it challenges the way healthcare is funded. It challenges actually everything. We are in kind of a, this is kind of an industrial revolution where everything is changed and people have to adapt. And I think everybody recognizes what you mentioned, that this is in a way a conservative system where it's very difficult to change because it is it's people's identities, it's the power structure of the healthcare system that's actually challenged with new technologies. And that's why it's so difficult to implement it. So I would say that the biggest challenge is to make the changes in organization and thinking in healthcare if we are going to benefit from the technologies and also use them in the best way for our patients.
You, Andrew, you work in the United States, but you know a lot about Norway. Do you think we're doing okay here? Are we speeding up enough?
I think you're doing extremely well here. And again, thank you for having us. And I have a flux capacitor in my pocket if you're going to bring us back to the future. There's a technical reference for you. And what we're seeing here and seeing elsewhere is that healthcare is going through a change that we probably have not seen before in at least our current generation, maybe two different generations. And what we are seeing is that the one thing that is saving us right now is technology. I still practice surgery, and I did a 6.5-hour surgery about a week and a half ago, and the patient left the hospital in 2 days.
How many hours did you say?
6.5.
6.5 hours.
And so we're seeing leaps in technology, and particularly in telemedicine, and just how we are working with our patients in ways that I've never seen before. So the single thing that has transformed my life, and really most importantly helped my patients, has been technology. So I commend you, and this conference has done a phenomenal job, but technology is, as healthcare is sinking it through us, a lifeline. And it's very exciting times.
Okay. Amy?
Yes. I think, you know, in our industry, we can suffer from shiny object syndrome, you know, convinced that the tool or the technology will give us the answers. I think in the future, the technology, we won't notice it. It will be seamless. It will be a part of our lives. And I think right now we're seeing technology be a huge distraction, and it aids us in interacting with the organizations that we need to. So the self-service aspect of healthcare, accessing data, information, records, that connectivity, it's really facilitating that. But in the future, I think that will be seamless so that you don't even notice the tech, and it really will focus on the relationships and helping people to manage their lives in a more healthful way so that they're well, they're living well, and they don't become patients to begin with. That said, of course, we need to improve patient experiences and leverage technology to that end, but wouldn't it be fantastic if the type 2 diabetes curve wasn't like this, and now Alzheimer's, which is being called type 3 diabetes, you know, we need to intervene and prevent, and I think in the future, hopefully, as business models evolve to support this type of thing.
Okay. Andrew, I want to invite you to have your 3-minute pitch on the subject you want to talk about. You can stand or you can sit in the chair in the middle. That's up to you, but I take your place.
Happy to stand. I am professionally schizophrenic. I work at UPMC, and 60% of my time, I work for the insurance side, where we cover 3 million lives. And then I also work on the provider side, where we deliver healthcare with hospitals and doctors. And one of the main projects I do with my colleague, Dr. Ravi Ramani, who's here in the front row, is telemedicine and remote monitoring. And about 2.5 years ago, we had a hypoxic patient result faxed to our primary care doctor on a Friday night that was picked up on Monday morning. And we realized we need to think about how we approach patients with telemedicine. And so for the last 2 years, we began a journey to build a population health telemedicine system at their homes. And these are for the sickest of the sick patients. They can have congestive heart failure. They can be terminally ill. We call them advanced illness care. And yes, we need to get into the diabetic realm, all the post-acute realm, and into the skilled nursing facilities. But what we've learned with remote monitoring, it really isn't, I agree, the bright, shiny object syndrome. It's really about what the patients want and how you interact with them at home. And what we found as a healthcare system is that the real problem we have with some of our sickest patients with congestive heart failure and terminally ill patients is how you actually work with them at home and manage them at home. And technically, yes, we can get them the tablets, and yes, we can give them the connections through Verizon or AT&T, or here it would be Telenor. This can be done, but how do you actually re-envision your entire care delivery in your hospital system as a payer, as a provider, and it's the same internationally as well? How do you actually look at your whole care delivery methodology? They say if you rebooted healthcare with a phone, what would it look like? And so one of the challenges we've had at UPMC is looking at telemedicine and remote monitoring as not a technology play, but it's a whole new care delivery that's patient-focused. And so the patients have a tablet, a blood pressure cuff, peripherals at their homes. These are shipped to them, they're mailed to them. They can open this up, they can turn this on, they can do care management. And the real challenge that we found with telemedicine is that as the data comes in, if I'm talking to you now and there's vital signs being sent to me, and I'm not aware of what the vital signs are, the patient could get bad care or I could be liable. So one of the main things we tried to do is to build an intelligent filter. It's a call center that handles the inbound data, makes sure the patients are safe, and then gives that data back to our primary care physicians and our subspecialist experts who manage them. So in short, what we're seeing right now is the best way to manage the population is where they want to be, which is at home or with their loved ones or in the communities. And how we do that with remote monitoring, giving them the devices, bringing it into the call centers, making sure that it's safe, and then passing it right to the front lines of medicine has really transformed the way that we see care. And we're early in this. We are very, very early in our journey. But our goal and our systems are built to handle 10,000 a day. Right now we're in the hundreds. But this truly to me is the future of healthcare. I still practice medicine. And the biggest question that I have right now is I actually don't know where healthcare takes place. Does healthcare take place in the hospital, at the home, in the clinics? And I will tell you right now, I actually don't know where it is, but I do think that healthcare will take place at home or in the cloud, so to speak, and that's what the patients want. So it's a very exciting journey for us. We're just at the beginning of this, and as a population health company that we are, it's one of the biggest priorities that we have right now moving forward. So, thank you.
Great. Let's see the editor chair is for you this 10 minutes. So, telemedicine is a part of the future health. What do you think about it, the others? Is that one of the real key factors which is going to help us?
Yeah, I'll take a shot. I think that, first of all, I totally prepared to slander them until I found out we weren't using American debate techniques today, so I'll have to go with...
Behind you when you
yeah, I appreciate that. That. Yeah, just dug up all the internet stuff I could, you know. I think that the issue about telehealth is we have a tendency using that phrase to get very confined very fast, but it is about connectivity. And it is about, and I think Andy hit it perfectly, where does health take place? And the reality is it takes place everywhere. And we'll talk about this more in a few moments when we talk about precision medicine, precision treatment, but it's ubiquitous. It is all around us. In a comment you made earlier, Amy, you talked about the fact that we're spending so much time talking about information or data, and in the future we won't be. I couldn't agree more. Today, when we go to build a hospital or we do anything from a technology standpoint, we don't talk about an electricity strategy, do we? I mean, you did in the 1800s, you did a little bit in the early 1900s, but we don't talk about an electricity strategy. And now we're spending all this time talking about an information strategy. I think that'll absolutely be gone in 10 years.
Yeah, you know, because
it will be assumed.
Yeah, yeah.
It'll absolutely be assumed. We're just catching up as an industry.
So, but because telemedicine has been a concept around quite a long time, and Andrew seems to make it work, but a lot of places we don't seem to make it work. So why is that? Is that a design problem? Is that a technology problem? Is that a social change problem?
I think there are a couple of factors. First of all, we do not have a clear landscape where the right incentives and reimbursements are the new normal. I think that will definitely paint a different picture and open up markets for telemedicine, or more broadly, what we like to call virtual health, which is more than telemedicine. So that will help. Secondly, there is a real need to shift from data, from technology, to experiences. If we are not able to do that, we are really not embracing that mindset of change, of organizations that can collaborate, that can look at the patient with an holistic view, multidisciplinary consultation that can be held with the best expert of teams independently from where they are. So as care and healthcare shifts from the waiting room to the living room, as we're spending a lot of money to really care for chronic conditions that have to be managed daily, there is no other way than creating connected and collaborative health experiences. Now, for that to happen, I think we need to stop thinking that this, or whatever form this has, is the conduit to the future, is the experience and the organizational setup and the collaboration that will make the difference. And mobility will be defined by having the right information to the right person in the right workflow so that we can use it easily in a protected way.
That's okay.
I'm curious how, now that UPMC is a risk-bearing organization, how that's changed your approach to telemedicine, if it's had a positive impact or changed anything at all.
Well, you found the body that I should also confess that I'm vice president of the American Telemedicine Association, so I'm highly biased here. And on the board of the ATA, we also know at some point it'll just become medicine. I did a laparoscopic fellowship in 2002 that doesn't even exist anymore. It's just surgery now. It's not laparoscopic surgery. It's just very, very commonplace. To answer your question specifically, that in a fee-for-service world where I see a patient and I submit a bill, it has been the bane of our healthcare system for about 30 or 40 years. It has eroded the ethics of American healthcare, and it has also impeded telemedicine. Telemedicine is just taking healthcare back to the patient, so it's humane. And what we've seen at UPMC, that of our $13 billion of our company, half of it is actually on the payer side. And what we've learned is the best way to do, or an excellent way to do, care management is with telemedicine. So as a payer-provider organization, the payer side views this as an invaluable tool to reach out to consumers. And it's something as simple as, help, I'm sick, would you please call me? It could be medical reconciliation. We've been working on that this morning. It could be, I have a sore throat. I don't want to drive through a tunnel. I don't want to pay for parking. I don't want to make my child late for school. I can just do this online. So for, I don't like calling it a consumer engagement strategy. It sounds sterile, but we view this as a critical priority for the payer, and that in that payer benefit design and how we work with our patients, it's absolutely invaluable. The amount of dialogue on this right now is extraordinary. It's a very exciting way forward. Thank you.
We are not so different as people may think. In Norway, we have one payer, but we have several providers. And this telemedicine, the way you use it, it challenged the way our organization of the division between primary healthcare and hospital healthcare, which are in Norway two completely different entities. And if we are going to utilize telemedicine, I totally agree with you. This is medicine. It's no longer telemedicine. We are using modern standard ways of communication in the way we treat our patients. And but in our country, it challenges who's responsible, and it's a matter of payment. Is this the responsibility of the primary healthcare or the hospital healthcare? I believe we also, you know, if every patient in the future has a lot of sensors, I heard some exciting lectures from parents talking about diabetes, treating, monitoring their own diabetes daughter. If we are going to take a responsibility for that in the hospitals, then we need ways to store, to act on all the information. These are going to be big data that we actually have to handle, allocate it to the right patient information, and give an alert. this challenge the whole way responsibilities in at least our healthcare is done. What about the primary healthcare? Is the primary doctor going to follow this up, or can we do it directly from the hospital? Will it be kind of a collaboration between the GP and the specialist? It challenged the whole structure of specialized and generalized healthcare.
I think structures will be challenged a lot in many ways. Okay, we'll stop here. Now you can, Elena, I invite you to have your small 3 minutes talk, and then Andrew, you can take the place of her so she can take the editor chair afterwards.
But you want me to stand for the pitch? Okay. So I must say I'm particularly humbled when I think about my job at Microsoft working on healthcare. There is no better place to be today as a contributor to the future of health and to the future of medicine when we think about the opportunity that technology has as a servant leader to patients, to health professionals, to payers, providers. And I particularly talk about technology as a servant leader. It is not about technology. It is about experiences. It's about the use of technology. And as we look at the future, definitely topics that are technological topics like artificial intelligence, machine learning, they will have a big role in shaping predictive and preventive medicine. Now, the question is, do we see a future in which bots or robots are replacing doctors? Absolutely not. I mean, Microsoft has put out there a vision for democratizing artificial intelligence. And when I think about that in health, is it how can we have intelligent systems that support clinicians in their decision making? They are irreplaceable. And at the same time, if you take the example of a tumor and the delineation of a tumor, that takes a long time, 40, 50 minutes to a clinician. And the difficulty to standardize this process, particularly as you have to look at a tumor across time and the evolution, longitudinal studies and so on. If you can train a machine to recognize the anatomy of an organ and then to do that work, to identify the tumor, and you can bring down the time to 2-3 minutes, serve that up to the clinician to prepare treatments. That is where the promise and the digital dividends, actually, of artificial intelligence will hold. If we can think of a situation in which we have rare diseases patients and we can identify very quickly with early diagnosis what's going on with that patient, and we can shrink the time of analysis, costly experiences through technology, that's a future that we subscribe on. So we have been very proud to start working around these collaborations. But as I close my reflections, I actually would like to bring up the fact that no matter what technology can offer, and no matter how bright the future and the promise will be, there is one key that holds that future, and that's trust. If we do not trust the technology, people will not use it. And so having a cloud that is trusted, having technologies that are trusted, is going to be our boldest imperative and our bigger challenge and opportunity. And that's where actually we're putting a lot of our focus. And I will welcome your reflections. Thank you. Thank you.
Okay. Well, for the clinicians, are you afraid to be put away by artificial intelligence?
It's not going to happen.
No, I ask them. Do you think clinicians are afraid for that?
I'm afraid for not having the support that she just described. I'm scared of not having it. When my surgeries are for Crohn's and ulcerative colitis patients, I cannot read the amount of information that's presented to me. It is impossible for me to read that amount. I simply don't have it within me, and I certainly don't have the RAM. I don't need more Microsoft RAM in my brain or IBM RAM. So my fear is that when I'm seeing patients, I might have missed a paper from yesterday or last week a randomized controlled trial, and I could be hurting them. I'm also scared about what I'm doing to the system if I don't know about the clinical decisions, because the medications my patients take cost between $100,000 and $300,000 a year. And so if I hurt one of these patients and they had a leak from their intestine or were put on the wrong medication, they could lose their jobs. Some don't eat for 6 months, and it can be very dramatic, and I'm actually just being very serious. So I'm scared about not having the right information to provide my patients with the best care. It took me a while to say this, but it's something that I've learned to, over time, adjust and adapt. And sometimes we get stuck in our ways, and physicians did say no to hand washing, antibiotics, DNA, and transplantation. We won't talk about that. But the technology world here is presenting us a new future that's safer, and frankly, it's more cost-effective for the national governments here of Norway, Sweden, and certainly our the U.S. government. So thank you for what all of you are doing to help us.
Hal, you work a lot with change management. Do you experience that hospitals, healthcare leaders, clinicians are afraid? They don't trust the technology? They don't know what they're going to have?
There's a couple of ways to look at it. I've never thought about it in the sense of not trusting, but most people do look at technology as a mugger in a dark alley when they're dealing with change management and systems. We build all of our systems in hospitals in the clinical domain to avoid or to sidestep risk. Everything we do is designed to minimize risk. And then we come in and we start introducing large-scale change. And we wonder why the antibodies of an organization jump in to push back against the change. And it's because it's absolutely in the core nature of how we've trained every single person in healthcare. But the counterbalance to that, when you start speaking of artificial intelligence, gets into the heart of knowledge management and the self-realization that none of us any longer can hold in our brains the information that is being produced at a scale that is unprecedented. So if you go back to the 1970s, three major journals being produced around the world, roughly 350 articles a year at a peer review level were being published. So if you were an extraordinarily diligent physician, as I'm sure you are, you would stay at bed every night, read one article, and you were totally up on all the scientific advancements. Today, there are over 4,000 peer review articles that are produced a year. So it is impossible for an individual to keep up. We have to have artificial intelligence sitting behind the most brilliant surgeon, the most brilliant practitioner, in order to support their intuitive thinking and their skill sets, which will never go away in need, but absolutely need to be supplemented and continue to be supported.
Eric, you work a lot with big data. Yeah. You agree with Hal in those way views?
Yes, you asked if clinicians were afraid of artificial intelligence. I think clinicians have a dual approach to this. We like to have all the best technology to perform safe treatment of our patients, of course. Mm-hmm. And everybody acknowledge that today we get more and more information that we actually cannot process as an individual. It's impossible to keep yourself updated. Mm-hmm. It's also, we work together with Microsoft in the SuperAsteria development of planning surgery. Mm-hmm. If we are going to offer our patients minimal invasive, in my department, we do about 60% of all liver resections in our hospital. They are performed laparoscopically. Mm-hmm. And to do that safely, we need to have decision support. So, you know, when you look at the liver and you start cutting, you don't see anything. And through a laparoscope, you can't feel the liver. You can't see anything inside it. Mm. So you have to do a planning and also intraoperative updating on the anatomy of the organ you're operating on. So, and this, after having introduced it, used it for some weeks, then we react the same way do you. How can we work live without it. I mean, it suddenly becomes irrational and careless not to use it. It becomes an ethical problem. So, and I think this is the way most of clinicians, this is the way we react to this technology.
Okay. When it comes to the matter of trust, Amy, you think design can help to make it more trustworthy?
Yes, absolutely. Well, when it comes to do clinicians trust the technology that they interact with, I think we see many doctors who have post-traumatic stress disorder from having to learn and integrate EMRs into their workflow to the point where it's like, oh, you have a new innovation? Awesome. So now I'm going to have to log into something else and do something else, to the point where 80% of doctor time is spent on administration and dealing with all of the information and the data. And so as AI accelerates, it will hopefully the technology can listen and transcribe and make sense of everything and bubble up the right information at the right time to the right people. But right now, doctors are burning out because they only have 20% of their time to care for patients, which is why they got into it to begin with, to heal. And so, like I said, if we more and more get the right information, have the technology take a back seat so that the human relationships can flourish, and that's what we'll hopefully see.
I think you touched on a very important revolution. Will be as technology steps back and we as humans are able to interact with that technology in a more natural way, because technology can sense the world and can be, you know, commanded by voice, by gesture, by gaze, but it becomes visible. Yeah, thanks. And for that to happen, I think we need to make a shift from systems of records to systems of engagement and insights. Because at the moment, we have, you know, to log in and so on, because the data that we need many times is captured. Security needs to become more easy and pervasive. And at the same time, the technology we use needs to have collaboration as a de facto important build, and engagement and insights, meaning not only, you know, let me log in, but give me back, render back the information that I need at the moment I need it. The question is, how do we charter that when we procure, when we design our projects? We need to think about the big principles for that, yes. Right?
Okay. I'll invite Hal to do his little speech, and you can sit over there. So the floor is yours.
So what we've been listening to fundamentally is a merging between information, capability, and the medical model, and its fundamental impact on patients. But I'm going to argue with you that we have to go much further than that. And I brought a piece of paper up, because we can still use these. And sitting behind it is an interesting discussion that took place a number of years ago, and even in 2004, the Commonwealth Fund looked up and noted that the key drivers of the impact of healthcare are, first of all, social and environment. That has a huge impact on an individual at about 20%. Personal behavior, 40%. Family history and genomics, 30%. And finally, the actual medical care that you receive, which is often well after the fact, about 10%. Now, in talking to any primary care physician, they would first thing they'll ask you is, tell me your family history. It has been for many years, and you'll hear it argued in just a few moments. One of the key ways in which we can expect what the impact will be to the individual, because it's a simple, non-technical reflection of your genetic makeup. But it is the genetic makeup that is now weaving its way into our health systems to unleash a much better understanding of the person. And what precision medicine is not just genomics. If you give it that narrow of a definition, you start to fail. It is, in fact, the totality of these components of socialization, the environment, the personal behaviors, all coming together along with the variabilities of your genomic makeup that allow us to look at a total person. It's not about patient-centered care, it's about person-centered health. And what the AI will start to bring to us, what the information combinations that have to bring to us on a cross-societal basis is that entire picture that ultimately impacts who we are, what we're dealing with, and how we move forward. That's really the definition that's sitting behind precision medicine. Genomics will just be a part of it. And you can start to see the difference already. The pharma industry is already looking at large-scale antibiotics? No. They're fundamentally gone. No one's researching that at scale anymore. They are focusing on cohorts that are large enough in genomic footprint to impact millions, so it's affordable, but not so broad as to miss the unique makeup of people and their individuality. That is what is sitting behind the formulas, the clinical decision support, and the efforts that are starting to be produced on a worldwide basis. So precision medicine is truly the definition that you're hearing largely behind much of the commentary that is up here today.
So I hear a lot about it, precision medicine. Is it here? Is it starting? How far have we come? Andrew, what do you think? Is it, doctor, how far have we come into this process?
I think we're entering the realm of the technical horsepower necessary to understand precision medicine and translate it into healthcare that we can, how we can use it. Because the genomic sequences are so large in terms of moving and storing them. And also, I think more important than that is what you said, the social determinants. And as healthcare leaves the hospitals and clinics and goes back to the patients where it always belonged, it always was there. We just took it away from them by accident for the last 100 years. As we go back to the patients, we're going to learn a whole new subset of patients, and it's about really their health, wellness, preventative care that matters to us. And our society has changed because we used to be farmers, and then we were in factories, and then we lived in this fear of the nuclear era, and we're in the fourth generation of society as we know it, which is the digital society. And the problem with the digital society, there wasn't a nuclear bomb that was dropped, there wasn't a factory you could smell, there wasn't a farm you could feel. We sort of slid into this and probably started around 2008. So as we go back to our patients, we're going to see a different group of people than we ever knew. So I do think that we're getting close to understanding it, and this is a very myopic view, so my apologies. But I think we're going to be able to bring these factors together, as you so eloquently described, with incredible enablers and leaders, and to make it into such a fashion that we can understand it on the front lines of medicine so that we can use it. And we see so much here in Norway that people are leading the world in this. And it's going to be an incredible journey in the next decade as we learn what our patients are really like at home in a digital world.
So, short question to Elena, because Andrew's talking about the technical horsepower we get.
Yes.
Is this freaking the industry out, genomics? Because this is really a huge amount
it's
of data.
It's fantastic. I think it's actually exciting a lot of technology players when you look at it. I mean, our research group, we have actually an incubation group looking only at genomics. And we were super pleased a couple of weeks ago when we proved that our cloud computing, as we were running the traditional methods of doing genomics, we could go 7 times faster all previous achievements. That means, you know, you can really bring down the hours of a diagnosis. You can save lives. So I think we are just opening a big door where, with the right ethics, with the right trust, with the right collaboration, we can really make amazing strides, because it is scary. Between 25 and 75 of the prescriptions still are failing because they are not tailored to the right gene, to the right individual, to the right situation.
Yeah.
And that is scary.
Yes. Yeah. You, Eric, you work with a big project, just started it on precision medicine.
Yes. We are trying now to move precision medicine into clinics. Then I think we should look at genomics as another tool that we get. There's been so many revolutions in medicine the last 100 years. Mm-hmm. You know, the last venesection to treat a patient in Europe was just in 1900. It's 100 years ago. Mm. That was not very precise. No. That was guessing medicine. Mm. And then we get more and more diagnostic tools, advanced imaging the last 20 years, making more and more personalized treatment. And then come the sequencing of the genome, which of course opens another huge box of opportunities. And I think this again will challenge us in many ways. For example, just one, as you said, there are many sides to it. We cannot really grasp the consequences. But there has become an ethical problem, the pharmacogenomics, for example, that you know we know for a fact that here in Norway, one common drug that we use in Norway, clopidogrel, I'm a cardiac surgeon, so I use that frequently, and about 30,000 new patients in Norway get this drug every year. We use that to make the blood thinner after an intervention in the vasculature. And we know also that 30% of the population of Norway, they lack the enzymes to actually utilize the drug. So we give almost 10,000 patients a drug that we know will never benefit them. They will only get the side effects. Mm. And we know that it's only a genomic test. If you do a genomic test, okay, we can avoid that drug for these 10,000 and give them something else that works. Mm. Think of all the money we spend on useless medicine. Yeah. FDA has a list of drugs where they recommend genomic testing. On that list was 30 drugs last year. Now I think last I checked, this was between 100 and 150 drugs.
Yeah, 155 at this point.
Exactly, 135. So this will of course become a demand from the public. Why should we get a drug without proper testing? It's going to be careless not to be more precise in a way. Yep. So this is the way precision medicine challenge the way we work.
Okay, we continue. Amy, can you do your little pitch?
Absolutely.
And tell us, and then Hal can see.
Can I have my slide? I'm just kidding. I'd like to talk about who's serving who here. I had a revelation while I was talking with patients and clinicians a couple of months ago, and it became clear that everyone was inmates in the asylum, that we have built a system where we expect people to serve the system. We want them to be obedient. We want them to manage their BMI. We want them to lose weight. We want them to do as they're told. And then clinicians, they're in the system as well. The system that we've designed, isn't good enough. It isn't pointed in the right direction because we're still stuck in a mode of treating sickness, which we need to do, but we need to move toward a mode of optimizing our lives for wellness. As you so aptly pointed out, there are so many things that lead to either health or sickness. So I'd like to propose how we focus on social determinants and health literacy and health promotion, because the lives that we live will either help us be well or make us sick. So when talking about social determinants, what we eat, the relationships we have. Smoking is a stress management program. Addiction is a healthy, unhealthy form of escape, right? So these things that we use to treat the problems in our lives end up creating more health problems for ourselves. And the problem is getting bigger and bigger. And so we need to figure out how to design interventions that fit with people's lives and help them to design their lives such that they can get toward greater health. One key aspect of that is what is called self-determination theory. It's part of humanism, which is the belief that every human wants to be the best version of themselves. And if we align with their intrinsic motivation and create the pathway for them to reach what they desire, not what we desire for them, but what they desire, that they'll be effective. And so those three tenets are autonomy, that people have control of their situation, their path, their environment. Competency, that people feel that they can be successful, and the challenge is not too big and it's not too easy, so that they disengage. And then relatedness. As humans, we want to relate to each other. And thirdly, I'd like to talk about precision experiences. We're talking about precision medicine. We're talking about how experience matters. We're in a position where we finally have the technologies available to create precision experiences that deal with the avalanche of big data coming from sensors, you know, biometrics, genomics, claims data, medical records. What has happened and what is going to happen? There's predictive models, so that this stuff can be churning in the background and enable us to design a very unique experience for each person and move beyond one size fits all. That's all. Thank you.
Well done.
So I start again with the clinicians. Have you, what about design in how you work?
I want to not go off on too much of a tangent, but there's a piece of Aristotelian logic here in rhetoric that's important, which is called speech act theory. It came out of Oxford, and it's called the locution, the illocution, and the perlocution. And in medicine, we don't understand this. The locution is what we say to our patients and our healthy patients and our sick patients. And the illocution is actually what they hear, but the perlocution is what they do from what they hear. In speech act theory, we are speaking to populations, we're trying to measure what they do, but we don't even understand what they hear. So if you look back at the good form of rhetoric, which is an important form of logic and argumentation, that we need to go back to the basics with our patients about how we talk to them, what are they hearing, and what are they doing, and what are they doing. And we have this incredible tool called a smartphone, and we have a new way of actually interacting with them. And I am a huge skeptic at times of Facebook, especially after a small episode in America called our election a few weeks ago. but I will say, when I do permanent ileostomies on patients where they have to wear a bag the rest of their life, or if I have to take out all of your colon, the most trusted source I can send them to right now is Facebook. Mm. And it still blows my mind. I had a patient last week, and her confidence to have her permanent ileostomy came from Facebook. So getting back to speech act theory, it's how we look at what our patients are hearing and saying and doing will be fascinating towards the future.
So. Actually, just a quick example to share how social media and online communities actually are also potential lever as peer groups and supports. Mm. I mean, in Belgium, there was actually a startup that put up a platform for all patients with cancer to share their experience, to ask for advice and so on. And it's amazing because maybe they understood better what other patients were describing, or in any case, they have measured that the results and how they were feeling just by being able to share and to understand and feel heard, they were doing better. So there is something there, maybe with the right conduit to explore more.
Hmm. Well, it's you can go to about 20 directions. This is a good one. I think we're hitting on a couple of critical points. So to your point about communication and where people get their knowledge or their information, yes, Dr. Google is the number one physician in the world. And I think every one of us in this room at one time or another has gone to the internet to look up a symptom, an idea, to try and get a knowledge on what is occurring. And so that's very limited, it is extremely pointed. When you start to look at the culmination of the information you brought forward, I think is really getting the point. How do you get into the hands of people in rational time? How do you understand the filtering which is taking place and what they are hearing? And how do you position it to an individual in a personal way? Mm. that really is about their particular circumstances, their particular background, their particular makeup as an individual. We are a long way away from that personalization happening in the home by yourself, by a prick of, you know, the blood to draw it in. We can do simple tests, but where will the complexity come from? But it is coming, but it is a question of timing, and it is a question of an unmet or needed medical environment. Mm-hmm. And I think we're just starting to understand where to grab a hold of it. Now, with that as a checkpoint, I'm going to go back to a conversation Elaine and I had five years ago in Brussels at Microsoft, talking about, I almost said a different word, talking about cloud computing and whether or not it was going to be the economic center of Microsoft's business plan. And at the time, I was questioning whether data centers, and I was thinking very provincially, were going to lower their cost and compete, and would cloud be able to take it on? But the enormity of the data that we are now processing and could never process at the individual data center level has opened up an entirely new segment that I could not see, which doesn't mean that much, but that many could not see. It's threefold, fivefold, tenfold improvement in our overall capabilities to process knowledge and information. So we're heading in the right direction.
Great.
Thank you.
Eric, I want you to do your presentation.
Yeah. Nard, can I ask her one question?
Yes, of course.
What could we be doing better? I mean, you're an expert in this field. How could we do better in this field of working with our patients and the technology and the interfaces? What should we be looking at?
Asking that question, right? It's the openness to exploring new methods and models. It's hard for an organization to disrupt itself and find out new ways of doing things, but through looking through the lens of a different organization, looking through the lens of the patient, of their family, bringing them to the table to figure out, okay, what is success and how do we get there together, as opposed to assuming this is the answer, that's the answer. So it's a good question. It's kind of the question of the hour.
Maybe before I give my presentation, I would also like to comment on your presentation, because I think it's the core of our profession is about communication. I mean, everything is about the relationship between the doctor and the patient, even if you are a surgeon or a general practitioner. And there is still a huge asymmetry between if you are very sick and you know, think you're dying and you come to a hospital and the doctor knows everything about you, there's a huge asymmetry in power between you and this person. Yeah. And I think to use technology to reduce this asymmetry, I think is one of the most important things we do, to enable the patient to meet and to understand. When you try to explain your patient what you're going to do, you are not exactly sure if they understand, because you think of this from two different worlds. And if we can use technology to bridge that gap, I think that's probably the most important thing we do. Actually, it was this problem that started the program I'm going to talk about, the Big Med program, because we had the program in our hospital where we saw that we released the patient journals for the patients to read on the internet. But when we started reading their own, I actually downloaded my own journal, and then I asked some of my family members to try to read it and understand what it stood there from my patient, my own record. I was hospitalized for blood poisoning some years back, and nobody could read one word because we use so many strange words. So we started developing programs where we could actually translate the text for the patient so they could understand automatically what's written in the patient records. And then when we now address this new topic of precision medicine, decision support in healthcare, then suddenly this also becomes very relevant. You need tools to be able to read the patient records to understand them if you're going to develop a tool for decision support. And we need decision support in healthcare, because today In our hospital, we have heart meetings, lung meetings, liver meetings, cancer meetings. We have a lot, we have meetings for every patient because we have so much information from different angles that not one single doctor makes the decision alone. And when we introduce genomics, this is today when we have a lot of images, we have a lot of blood samples, we have a lot of information, and we need actually already now to automate the interpretation of these data. If we want to integrate genomics into this decision-making, it has to be... the decision-making has to be automated in some sense. And that's, in a way, bringing together the artificial intelligence, the big data challenges, into decision support tools that we can utilize, and then so we get more standardized decisions. Because what we are deciding about life and death of these patients. Do they need surgery or not? Can we treat them with surgery? Do they need palliative treatment? Do they need special drugs? Do they need targeted drugs? We can sequence the tumors, the bacteria, the patient themselves, and we can decide the right drug. But it requires, it compiles an enormous amount of data when we do all this testing. And we are now together with several companies, among them IBM and, of course, the Watson technology, to see if we can integrate a decision support tool into the pathway of the patients, the patient pathway through the hospital. And I believe this is absolutely necessary if we are going to utilize the opportunities that lies in the new technology. So this is absolutely necessary to develop in the next 2 to 3 years. Otherwise, we will have a lot of problems coping with the data overflow. So this is putting precision medicine into clinical everyday practice. It's a computer question. Thank you.
Anyone want to jump in? Where are we?
Maybe a comment from the promise to reality. Mm-hmm. I think we need to be fast and diligent that we shrink the time in which we paint those beautiful pictures of what machine learning and artificial intelligence can do, and we come to what we can deliver now. Mm-hmm. Because I'm afraid that, as it was with the big technology projects, 10, 15 years ago, in which we would solve all the issues, then we got very much disappointed, and we don't want to risk that again. So I am trying, particularly as we engage in machine learning and AI projects, to say, okay, let's be very focused on this we can deliver. So if it is giving oncologists a database that is automized or natural language processing capabilities that can scan all those 4,000 journals and bring back in a condensed way the theory today, or a clinician will never dig into databases to see how the specific gene correlates with specific situation of a patient, but we can automate all of that today. We can, in the UK, Canteron system is doing that in 3 clicks, and it has a blanket contract with all the NHS trusts. Mm. This is reality today. Let's start experimenting with what we have and progress from reality.
Mm. I would look at it from a holistic standpoint again. I think that the caution components and the practicality of it are very important. Mm. But we have to become demanding. Mm-hmm. Of the governments around us, about the people around us, about our institutions, to pave the way in creating both the reimbursement policies and the demanding of the bringing together of the data and the holistic approach. If we do not do that, we will go and stay within the culture, which will take longer to change than it needs to. And culture needs a kick in the tush from time to time. It's a technical term that I can explain later on. But the reality is that we really need to open our thoughts to how we can create faster adoption through capability, mm-hmm. And it will not come down just to the individual physician. It's important, but this is team-based care. This is holistic view from a societal standpoint, and we need everyone collectively pushing for it.
I think it's a really good point, the holistic point. I think we're spoiled. We luxuriate in these big budgets and timelines. I think we can take a cue from global health when innovation is happening in countries without the budgets and the infrastructure that we have. They can invent something from scratch. It has to be nimble. It has to work. It has to be cheap. Mm. And sometimes the cheapest interventions, free interventions, are the most effective. So for example, one of the people in the design session had that thing around your neck where you can hit it, press the button when you've fallen, but many people press it when they're lonely. Loneliness and relationships for the aging, this is not an expensive drug, but it's something that we can design into our systems. Yoga has been around for 10,000 years and is scientifically proven to improve, you know, outcomes. But it's not, so I think we focus on what we can see and what we can kind of bill for, and we kind of miss everything else. It's a good point.
Okay, and your last word is on you, and then we take a little yoga session with Amy.
Fine.
Yeah.
One of the things when you hear about the cognitive computing era that's upon us is about a third of my life is in hospital operations, not in the OR, but actually running a system for remote monitoring. And it's more of a whole IT system built on a business model for cost avoidance so the consumers are happy. And one of the things that we don't want to forget here is that the artificial intelligence and cognitive computing can do an enormous amount to help the operational aspects of healthcare and make it safer and better. Because if you look at call centers, look at other types of duties that are going on when it's raining or snowing or Christmas Eve or New Year's Eve, if you can do it predictively, if you can do it repetitively, but if you can start to build the wisdom from all these interactions. Dr. Romani and I were stunned in 3 months. We pushed 200,000 survey questions to 500 patients that had an average age of 74. And there's no way anyone in this room could process that. But if we can get artificial intelligence in the back, helping to buttress the payer-based call systems, the population health of Norway, help build the vision for the e-health directorate, and help to support regions like HSO, this is one of the key features. It's a way for us to start and show the patients and build the trust that you talk about as well.
Okay. We have two big monitors here telling us that time is up. So I think we could continue talking about it. I think we are going to continue to talk about it. Before you go back to the future, I hope you join us at the dinner. And the rest of the EHIN, thank you very much for your...
Thank you.
Yes.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
I enjoyed meeting you. It was a real pleasure.
The same.
Thank you, Anne.